Hello, and welcome to the Avi Solutions webinar series on fiber to the antenna installation. My name is Jennifer Faircloth, and I'm a senior marketing manager here at Avi. This webinar will cover cable and antenna testing. Our presenter is Janice Sanchez, regional product manager for Avi. Other webinars in the series cover fiber inspection and connectivity, front haul test, and fiber certification. To access all of the webinars and related material, please visit theavisolutions.com/FTTA. Now, Janice, please take it away.
Cable and antenna systems remain the cause of many cell malfunctions today. It is estimated that more than 70% of problems in base stations are in fact related to the cable and antenna systems. There are many reasons for this to be the case. Among others, for example, components can get damaged due to weather conditions, including lighting, weather intrusion, corrosion. In other instances, the problems can be caused by items not being installed properly, like swap antennas, loose connectors, improper torquing, and similar things. The best time to identify many of these problems is during the commissioning stage, right after installation has taken place. But before the new cell site becomes active, however, regular maintenance and testing of these elements is required to identify new uses and fix these before they have an impact in the overall network performance, like, for example, a reduction of the cell site coverage, slow throughputs, and so on. There are a few key measurements to detect and resolve these problems associated to cable and antenna systems. For example, we have return loss or VSWR, distance to fault, insertion loss, RF power measurements. During this presentation, we will look in more detail into these metrics and how to effectively measure it. Through this presentation, we'll go around two concepts that may replicate in diverse ways. One is signal reflection, and the other is the concept of signal loss, which is typically referred as a form of signal attenuation. Reflection and loss in RF transmission can be compared to what happens when a light wave crosses a lens, where part of the incident light will be reflected by the lens, like a sort of a mirror effect, if you want, and the part of the light that is being absorbed by the lens is actually can be attenuated as well. Signal reflection is referred to the amount of energy or power that gets reflected by the cable and antenna system when the main communication signal is transmitted through this system. Different components may cause reflection back to the main source. Reflections are, in fact, an unwanted behavior for any communication system. Also, they are the result of impedance mismatching through the feed line by different elements like cable jumpers, connectors, adapters, up to the transmitting antenna. The main consideration is that any amount of energy that gets reflected is in fact not being transmitted by the antenna, which results in a waste of energy by the transmission system and a reduced network performance. For example, the less energy being transmitted, the less coverage that cell site will provide. On the other hand, the effect of attenuation is sometimes referred also as a cable loss. However, it's important to notice that not only cables, but other components can also introduce attenuation and so reduce the level of signal power being transmitted at the end compared to the power of the original signal at the source. Generally speaking, cable and antenna analysis measure the ratios of reflected and transmitted signals to the original incident one that we were intending to transmit. Another critical point is the one related to calibration of the cable and antenna analyzer before we can perform any measurement in the field. Calibration is required so we can compare and normalize the results of the measurements of our cable and antenna system with those of known references. These references are provided by the so-called calibration kits that typically include three different references: an open that emulates a transmission system with an open end, a short one that emulates a shortcut, and a load that provides the 50 ohm reference that is useful, the one that we use in these cell site systems. There are two main categories of calibration kits these days. One is referred as the mechanical one, that includes each reference in a different port connector, which the user then needs to change and connect during the calibration procedure. The other category is referred as the electronic calibrator, which includes only one connection port, and the switching between different references is done electronically through an internal circuitry, typically controlled by the test analyzer through a USB controlling cable. Once proper calibration has been performed, it is possible to proceed with signal reflection measurements through the entire cable and antenna system. There are two different standardized metrics that are used by technicians in the field to measure signal reflection. One is called return loss, and the other is VSWR, which stands for voltage standing wave ratio. As a matter of fact, both metrics indicate how well the cable and antenna system is matched in terms of impedance. VSWR is also a measure of how efficiently RF power is being transmitted through the transmission line and into the end load. Note that return loss is measured in dBs, while VSWR is measured as a value number in relation to one. In the ideal situation that an antenna and cable system is capable of transmitting all the power originated at the source, that means without any reflection or loss, the VSWR be 1-to-1 and the return loss will be at infinity value. On an opposite example, if a transmission system was reflecting, say, 97% of the incident power, almost a total reflection, basically, then the VSWR in this case could go as far as 65-to-1, and the return loss might be only 0.26 dB, a terrible value for any transmission system. Regardless if you prefer to measure reflection in terms of VSWR or as a return loss value, the good news is that modern cable and antenna analyzers support both types of metrics, and in fact, with tools like the Viavi Solutions JD720C series, you can even visualize both measurements in parallel in a single dual mode screen, like in this example. Note how VSWR return loss in these examples are always measured for a specific frequency range, which is intended to be the typical operating range of the transmission system of interest. For example, if you were to measure a cell site transmitting GSM technology in 900 MHz, you will be configuring your reflection test for that specific frequency range around 900 MHz. And also, your previous calibration steps would have been completed at that same frequency range for maximum test result accuracy. Distance to fault is another important measurement that helps to identify any possible elements in the cable and antenna system that are producing the largest signal reflections, which could be impacting negatively the performance of the signal transmission. Distance to fault measures four locations in the transmission system of the cell site, indicating where are the biggest signal discontinuities in terms of VSWR or return loss. Note, however, that distance to fault is a measurement in the time domain as opposed to VSWR that operates in the frequency domain, as we just mentioned before. Because the technician has also access to the propagation velocity specifications of the cables installed in the cell site, the distance to the faulty element is easily calculated as the result of that velocity by the time measured. Modern cable and antenna analyzers include databases of several hundred of cable types, which automatically factors in the relative propagation velocity into the distance to fault measurement. As shown in this measurement example, the distance to fault can be presented in the format of VSWR or as a return loss, or even as both metrics simultaneously if required. Note how these are now measured for a specific distance range instead of a frequency range. The distance value, where a main discontinuity is marked, indicates the position in the cable and antenna system where the culprit element is located through the feeding line from the source where the test unit is placed. When a given network component is identified as the faulty element, like, for example, a cable jumper, a connector, or an adapter, the technician can proceed to the replacement of that element or else to fix it on the spot if it happens to be just a loose connector or similar. So far, the previous measurements that we have discussed have all been related to the overall performance of the entire cable and antenna system. However, sometimes it's important to confirm the individual contribution in terms of attenuation or gain that comes from a single individual component within that entire system. This individual item measurement is often referred as cable loss or insertion loss. Note that when we say loss in this context, it is meant as an attenuation, something that weakens the original signal power. But in the opposite way, certain active elements, like the amplifiers, for example, can also introduce a gain on top of the original signal power, which in fact is the opposite of a loss. In terms of measuring loss or gain, the elements of a given cable and antenna system can be classified as one-port or two-port elements. A typical one-port element is the cable jumper, which is measured only on one side, which two-port elements include instead an input and an output port that need to be connected to the cable and antenna analyzer. Examples of two-port components are filters, attenuators, amplifiers, and similar. This example shows the measurement for a one-port element and is also commonly referred as cable loss measurement. In the screenshot, you can see how a pass-fail threshold marks indicates the range of frequencies for which this cable presents the maximum attenuation values. Indeed, the loss figure for many components changes at different frequency ranges, which is an important consideration as you want to make sure your cable loss is minimal at the specific frequency ranges that the cell site needs to operate. Another related measurement is the one-port phase that can help technicians with systems tuning the antenna element in particular, for example. This other example shows a two-port measurement applied to a type of element called TMA or tower-mounted amplifier. Amplifiers have the ability to increase the power at the output of the received signal in the input. This is often referred as adding a gain to the signal. This two-port measurement allows to validate how much gain, in fact, a given amplifier is providing, and if that gain is within the expected or desired values, or else if the amplifier is no longer operating at the specified gain levels. As with many other types of measurements, the two-port gain or loss is always related to a given frequency range. To test tower-mounted amplifier, a special feature called bias T is usually required. The bias T is a function available in many cable and antenna analyzers that allows to inject a DC signal into the amplifier to activate the amplifying of the signal received at the input port. Moving into a different aspect of the cell site testing, the RF power measurement allows to validate the total RF power being transmitted into the cable and antenna system. There are two types of power sensors that can be used for this purpose. One is the so-called terminating power sensor, where the sensor interrupts the power transmission, effectively disconnecting the cable and antenna system from the transmitter, and absorbs all the power to measure it. To prevent damaging the sensor, this procedure usually requires the use of an external attenuator device. The other is the so-called directional power sensor, which connects in between the transmitter and the cable and antenna system and measures the transmitted power without the need to interrupt the transmission service. Also important today is the ability to control remotely the device and the ability to generate different types of reports, including the location of GPS information into that report. Modern tools like the Viavi Solutions JD720C allow to control the device over Bluetooth or Wi-Fi or even Ethernet over a network, and also provide GPS location stamps for all the measurements, including the ability to generate configurable PDF reports. Viavi Solutions Test Wizard is another utility that allows managers to graphically create test procedures for example, for methods of procedures and distribute these through a free cloud service to all the cell technicians in the field for reliable and consistent and systematic testing. The advantages of this systematic approach to testing in the field is that all the technicians basically are now with a set of guidelines in conformance with the mobile operator pass-fail criteria. Also, there is a self-guided test sequence indicated by the instrument, so which this minimizes the need for training or product certification. The final results after each test are automatically uploaded into the StratoSync cloud service, expediting the installation and maintenance best practices in cell sites. The Viavi StratoSync cloud service is free with any Viavi Solutions product and allows to do asset management, basically managing and tracking the whereabouts of all the test instruments in the field. This includes, by the way, an anti-theft mode that blocks the instrument in case being stolen. Data management, which collects test results from entire networks and upload those results automatically in a central repository, and also notifies users of new firmware releases and product options available through a Viavi updating system. Viavi Solutions portfolio for cable and antenna analyzers include different options covering different frequency ranges from a basic 2.7 gigahertz up to 4 gigahertz or even 6 gigahertz with one or two port measurement capabilities. These instruments allow for insertion and gain loss measuring, cable antenna analysis in general, RF power metering, optical power metering, fiber inspection, and includes additional options like the test wizard, remote control, and cloud services we just mentioned. There is a number of Viavi RF test educational resources available to customers through our website. This includes application notes, like antenna insulation testing with a cell advisor, analyzing distance to fault and VSWR efficiently with the cell advisor JD720C series. We have an excellent ebook basically to go through all the different aspects of commissioning a fiber to the antenna cell site. We have posters available that shows the different items that require for the installation maintenance of a cell site. We have a number of case studies as well, and product briefs and brochures. More information and access to all this documentation is available on viavisolutions.com/cell-site-installation for your reference. This concludes the presentation for cable and antenna testing. If you have any questions, please address those to this email address, janice.sanchez@viavisolutions.com, and we will be more than glad to respond to any questions that you may have in this regard. Thank you so much.
Hello, and welcome to the Viavi Solutions webinar on fiber to